In this video, we are going to talk about Hornet's diffraction at circular aperture. Here, we will consider two cases, one when the wavefront is spherical and another when wavefront is planar. In both these cases, we will discuss about intensity at center of the screen. In later part of this video, we will also talk about intensity at non-axial point. So let us start with first case, which is spherical waves. Let us have a source S, which is making a pattern at point P. As it is Fresnel's class, we have to remember that distance between source and aperture and the observation point, both will remain finite. We are considering a small aperture. As you can see, these vertical black lines, let us name them A and B. Now, this source S is emanating spherical waves, which will be obstructed by aperture AB, and the distance from source to the slit is A, small a, and that from slit to the observation point is small b. O is center of the slit, and here also pole of the wavefront. Here, we need to calculate the path difference between the waves reaching from S to P. So one path would be SBP and SAP, and the direct path would be SOP. Also, one more point to remember here is, even if the wavefront is spherical, we are taking its only very small part and assuming it to be still planar. We are not considering any curvature in the wavefront. Here, this dotted black line is representing radius of circular aperture, and which is represented by small r. Now it's time to calculate path difference. Path difference is generally represented by capital delta, and in this case it would be difference between SAP and SOP. So let us write capital delta as SA plus AP minus SO plus OP. So SA to AP minus SOP, that is the direct ray. If you feel I am going too slow, you can always increase the speed. Applying Pythagoras in this triangle, we will have SA as root of A square plus R square, and AP as root of B square plus R square, as in this triangle, minus SO plus OP, which is nothing but A plus B. Let us rewrite it, and taking A and B out, the expression would be modified. All this we are doing in order to apply binomial expansion. Binomial expansion is given by 1 plus x raised to n equals 1 plus nx if x is very much less than 1. So if we don't take out a and b, our quantity after 1 will not become less than 1. The quantity r by a and r by b both are very much less than 1, as r is radius of circular aperture and A and B are observation distances, which are most of the time in tens of centimeters, and radius is in few millimeters. So here, as our A and B is much greater than size of the slit, so R by A whole square is very much smaller as compared to 1. Applying the binomial, quantity inside the bracket would become 1 plus R square upon 2A square, and similarly for B. And further solving, we will get capital delta as R square by 2 into 1 by A plus 1 by B, where A is distance from source to aperture and B is distance from aperture to observation point. From Fresnel's zone theory, we know that this capital delta path difference would be integral multiple of lambda by 2, because every successive zone is separated by lambda by 2 path difference, and let's say we have m number of zones, then delta will be equal to m times lambda by 2. Substituting this, we can rewrite the expression and rearrange to get the relationship between m, lambda, r, a and b, which is 1 by a plus 1 by b equals m lambda by r square. This is our final expression for Fresnel's diffraction at circular aperture. Point P would be of maximum intensity if m is odd number, and it will be of minimum intensity if m is even. Now let us consider second case, which is plane waves and can be regarded as a special case of spherical wavefront. If we are observing a point source at infinite distance, then it can be treated as a plane source. Or in lab, when we want to do experiment with plane waves, we prefer laser, as the laser's divergence is negligible. In other words, A becomes infinity, which is distance from source to aperture. So if we substitute A tending to infinity in the above expression, we can rewrite that as 1 by infinity plus 1 by b equals m lambda by r square, which will give us the final expression as r square equals mb lambda, or r equals root of mb lambda. And in this case also, p would go maximum for odd number of zones and minimum for even number of zones. In summary, in circular aperture, if the wavefront is spherical, point P would be minimum or maximum will depend upon A as well as B, whereas if wavefront is planar, then it will only depend on B for a particular wavelength. This M is called as Fresnel number, which is very important characteristic for Fresnel class of diffraction. Now we can rewrite the same expression in order to get M as 1 by A plus 1 by B into R square by lambda, where m is Fresnel's number. Now if we substitute the quantities related to a certain experimental setup for Fresnel's class, we will always get m as greater or equal to 1. For planar wavefront, when a tends to infinity is given by r square equals mb lambda. Here if we say b is also tending to infinity, then we are going into Fraunhofer's regime, where both source and screen are at infinite distance. So for a constant wavelength and a particular aperture of radius r, if b is tending to infinity, that means m will tend to 0. Thus for Fraunhofer's class, m is tending to 0 or in between 0 and 1. Thus we can differentiate between Fresnel's and Fraunhofer class on the basis of Fresnel number as well. For Fresnel's class, m is always greater or equal to 1, whereas in Fraunhofer's class, m is tending to 0. Physically, it means that center of the Fresnel pattern can be either dark or bright depending upon odd or even m, but center in the Fraunhofer's class is always bright because m is always less than 1. Now let us consider Fresnel's diffraction at off axis point due to a circular aperture. First, let us look at the intensity at a point which is at the center. And let's say the situation is such that two complete zones are filling this aperture. So let's say zone number 1 and zone number 2. Now if we move our observation point little beyond, in order to draw wavefront, first we need to join this source to our new observation point, which is P prime. Let us name our previous center of the zone as O. So our new center of the zone, which is pole of the wavefront, is now shifted. At point P prime, as pole is shifted upward,
the center of the zone will shift upward. So now even third zone will be exposed. 2 is cut partially and 3 is now exposed. As P prime will keep on shifting up and up, this will keep on going up, and more number of zones will come into picture. So if we want to write the amplitude at P, we would write that as A1 minus A2, which is nearly equals 0, which is a minimum. But for P prime, we would write that as A1, which is complete, A2 is half exposed, and A3 is also half exposed. So that we can write as A1 by 2 minus A2 by 2 plus A1 by 2 plus A3 by 2. So these two will be almost cancelled, and we will get a point which would be bright. In this way, even if the center was dark, when you move away from the center at off axis point, depending upon the number of zones being exposed, it will change from minima to maxima. If this P prime is shifted even farther, in that case P4 will also come into picture, that is the fourth zone will also come into picture, and again this will go to minima.
In this way, depending upon number of exposed zones, intensity at off axis point can be predicted. In summary, we looked at Fresnel's diffraction at circular aperture because of spherical and planar wavefront, and looked at the physical significance of Fresnel number. After that, we discussed intensity at off axis point. That's it for this video. Thank you.